Just a heads up to the audience, there would be a poll. It'll contain three questions, and it'll be flashing on your screen for a maximum 1 minute. I would urge you to take part in the poll. And if you do have questions, please put it onto the chat box. So to kickstart the questions, I'm going to ask our Director General of BOI, with all this conversation about how do we engage with the world and get kickstart exports. I recall somewhere in March when you did come in, you had plans of changing the investment fabric of Sri Lanka. And could you elaborate what kind of areas have you fundamentally kind of changed? And secondly, how does that relate to an FDI perspective as well as a domestic market perspective?
Thanks, Kasturi. I think when I took over March, we looked at all the geopolitical shifts that Prabhash was talking about, and to take advantage of that and really build the country that we all aspire to live in for the next 10 years, where we want to have 6 to 7% GDP growth, where we're going to double our GDP, certain amount of knowledge thrust and all that. So for that, we have to change the economic fabric of the country. So when we put down the strategy, it actually had 7 pillars. One was creating compelling investment climate, attracting targeted investments. And I think Prabhash also talked about some of the sectors that we jointly target at, providing end-to-end investor support. And also, as an organization, how BOI is going to be revamped to be able to cater to the existing investors as well as the potential investors, not just the traditional pillars that we used to have, but also the more complex pillars like financial sector, ICT, and so on and so forth. And also embracing technology and upskilling our people within BOI and outside in the government organization apparatus to be able to provide a seamless service. Now, and of course, the other one was the partnerships that we talked about. And I think there was quite a healthy and a strong partnership that we have with Chamber of Commerce as well in terms of going out to the market. Now, if you take fast forward today, what has that happened? One is that if you look at post-election, the BOI was kept under HE, the president, and was elevated to a level that it's one of the institutions that give direction to the country. So that's one of the things. So that means in terms of the policy point of view, in terms of the sector's point of view, in terms of the way that you're driving certain things. The second one is under HE, he created a cabinet subcommittee to address every investment-related issues, where I was the convener. With that, actually enables to flush out any nagging issues, problems that we have in terms of the investment point of view. So we have a strategy. There are certain things that have happened. Now let's think about what elements did we try to attract or address in the strategy to create an investment climate. And then I will talk about some of the incentives that the budget has supported and given a little bit of tailwind, and what it entails for both the investors who is listening from foreign countries as well as the local investors. One is, I think, the export diversification, I think Prabhash also talked about. So when from BOI point of view, there are 5 thrust sectors. When you look at manufacturing, there's electronics, electrical, which we talked about, fabric. We have a $5 billion vertical, but $2 billion has been imported, so our upstream fabric is critical. Then we need to have the electronics and electrical part of it. Then you have the whole ICT segment. So ICT, I talk about the whole pyramid, where you have the product companies on the top, the service delivery on the middle, and then the IT BPO on the bottom. So all these, there's quite a bit of opportunities, and some of the big names that came in were like HCLs in the world. Then, of course, you have tourism. Tourism has 2 parts of it. One is the tourism-related infrastructure part, the wellness, and so on and so forth that we need to drive. Then on the agri, which Prabhash also talked about, agri-processing. Because the reason why we need agri is that at the onset today, we are a $4,000 GDP per capita country. When we double our economy, in the next 5, 6 years, we're going to be 6,000, 8,000. So we need to have inclusive growth. That's very important. Otherwise, you'll have a big void between the haves and the have-nots. And then you need to have the infrastructure which is needed, both electricity, roads, rapid transits, and so on and so forth. So those are the kind of 5 thrust sectors that we talked about. And export diversification comes through that. And if you look at what the budget has offered, they've given specific tax breaks, 5-year tax breaks for these thrust industries that we talked about, ICT including, fabrics, agriculture, tourism, so and so forth. And pharma also, and because at the end of the day, there's so much of these supply chain rebalancing happening. So because of that, the pharma is becoming one of those critical components, and that also enables us to uplift our capabilities in the country. So pharma also will get that sort of a tax break that comes with that. So that's kind of a push that's been given by the budget. Secondly, every investor that in my past life at BCG, when I went to multiple countries, would talk about is the policy consistency. And this is something that we were really bad at as a country. Right? Every budget, every year, the tax regime changes, the policy changes. At least in this budget, they've given a certainty that, you know, the investment climate and the certain tax structures will remain put for the 5 years. So that's an important thing. So one of the other things that, apart from those thrusts that the budget has provided, what are the things that the BOI is looking to move? One is the catalytic investments. So one of some of the catalytic investments is pharma is one of such things. But on the tourism segment, whether it's gaming, whether it is entertainment, those are things that's what is needed. Then the other one is the market attractiveness. The reason being is our workforce upskilling is needed because we are predominantly apparel related. So there's a lot of operational activities that are going through VTA to upskill the workforce. We need to get women labor participation increased, then also to get the universities, foreign universities into the country to build the talent pool we need for the ICT segment. So those things are ongoing. Then the other aspect of it is certain, say for example, labor law. Now people have different objective opinions about the labor law, but if you really look at because of its restrictiveness, Sri Lanka is one of the most complying nations in terms of when it comes to sourcing. But within that framework, you need to have certain flexibility when you go into the new sectors. So that needs to get changed. And also the bankruptcy laws, the investment related protection and all that needs to come in. Those have been addressed. And the one of the last things that I want to talk about is the BOI Act point of view. When the BOI Act was drafted in 1978, it was all powering and was could give an investor a frame of mind and a easiness that once you come in through BOI, everything is taken care of. But over time, that legal framework has got eroded. And of course, the world has also evolved. So we really need to up what BOI could offer, but also reclaim back some of these capabilities that we had in the law. So if I step back, then with all these changes that what you're trying to do, what is in for a foreign investor as well as what is in for a local investor? One is, as I mentioned, we are going through that 4,000 GDP to 6,000 GDP, kind of that interesting band, which I call in the economy, which gets you the J curve. So if you really get the policies, and I think that's what Prabhash was talking about, and that's what we are also trying to advocate and put it in, and also the right structures, so you'll have a rapid growth. So in that related, so not just the local growth, but also industry growth. So, and five verticals to, we have got really focused. So there's investors who can come in, invest, and get the benefits from it. Then for the local investors, so there's investments granted to reinvest their earnings and expand their businesses. And also there's an opportunity to diversify because the emerging opportunity that you see, just like what Prabhash talked about, brand building. Like for example, we are good at exporting our cinnamon and pepper, but you're gonna get GI indications with that. So now you can really build a brand. So you have Ampare Kaha is better than anywhere else, right? So you have the high cumin levels. So there are new business opportunities that's gonna come in. Of course, if you're gonna, meaning post-COVID, if your tourism comes back as a service sector for 10 billion, that's a huge industry to build on. So I think there's ample opportunities. It's just that picking and choosing the ones that you want to engage in. I think in that sense, I would say Sri Lanka is open for business. I think with all these, welcome any investors who are listening in to come and look at Sri Lanka.
Thank you. Thank you, Sanjay. And Aja, just you being the chairman of a leading FMCG conglomerate here in Sri Lanka, tell us now in this whole conversation about how does the private sector connect to the global trade? What is your view? What do we need to do? Are we ready for it? And I heard that there is a competency elevation which is needed. Your thoughts?
Thank you, Kasturi. First of all, let me thank our audience, which has joined us today all digitally. It's an amazing moment where the Chamber of Commerce is actually reaching 2,000 and thousands of people, of companies that are going to change the economic climate of the country. So my big thanks to Dr. Hans, to Manjula and the team behind this event, which is extremely seamless. And one must add that technology did not fail us today, which is great. Unilever, as you said, Kasturi, has been present in Sri Lanka for over 82 years. 96% of our products are made locally. We pride ourselves in brands, which I think are Olympic brands, brands like Lifebuoy, Signal, or Sunlight. They are the jewel of our crown because they serve consumers. They serve consumers every day, making them our priority. This gives us a huge responsibility, guys. It gives us responsibility towards our consumers. They are our king. It gives us responsibility towards our retailers. We touch 100,000 retailers is what Unilever touches every day. We have 50 distributors, partners around the country. If they don't flourish, we do not flourish. So the idea of partnership is the only way for us to operate. And we cannot win if our suppliers do not win, if our partners do not win. So my first point to your question, Kasturi, is to say, first of all, we are firmly rooted here, and our intention is to absolutely do what His Excellency had said, grow the GDP, because big companies are those that are able to grow the GDP. They are the highest payers, they are the innovators, they are the game changers. Nonetheless, middle of this year, we all understood the importance of global trade. Really, when every country had closed because of the crisis, what we needed is to open up. So let me speak here about something Prabash had said, which is, what is the strategy to open global trade? Because the reality is every company wants to do it. Is it simple? No. I believe that every strategy is based on two questions. Where to play? That's the first question. Which is the set of country which will need Sri Lankan products more than any other product, and why? This is what Sanjay had said about the policies. And then how will we win? Now, this is actually the exercise we have given to our team. They have gone to select what are the markets which we believe are going to be fertile market for us. But let me position my speech about how to win, because I think this is where the needle had to shift. How to win for me, Prabash, Harsha, and Sanjaya, you spoke so eloquently about the processes, the policies, the free trade agreements, the currency stability, the stability that the budget speech is going to provide. This is not really in the control of the private sector. And I think all we can do is trust. Trust that the government and all the officials are doing everything they can to make export progress. And that's really the prerequisite that at Unilever we put on the table. Was this year easy? No. Have we been stopped? Yes. Do we believe this is going to be in the long term? Absolutely not. So where we focus our effort is on building a higher order benefit to what we send. I think this is something Prabash has spoken about. It is at the heart of what we do. We believe that brands with purpose last. When you export, we don't export a merchandise or a good. We export a value. We export a brand that is more than just a packaging or a brand name. We export a brand that is doing something for the community. That is a reality. When I export a Signal, I also export not only a toothpaste, but a brand that has helped 2 million Sri Lankans have a better smile through cavity decay. When I export Lifebuoy, I don't export a soap. I export a brand that is working every day with the community to improve hand hygiene. I think Prabash had spoken about it very, very well. And this is the way to go. Allow me to give an example of what we're doing, as you said, in terms of competencies. Probably most of you don't know that Unilever has a factory in Agropatana, where 100% of our export, yes, 100% of the export is just from instant tea. Now, what makes this instant tea special? First of all, it is grown in Sri Lanka. It's a Sri Lankan tea. Second of all, the entire process is sustainability driven. 96% of our water is own harvested. Our CO2 and our energy is amongst the best in the world. This year, we have beaten the US, yes. Instant tea was actually imported from both Sri Lanka and the US, and this year we have made it 100% come from Sri Lanka. What most of you don't know, that 2 billion bottles of Lipton iced tea come from Sri Lanka because we have positioned it on an ethical, sustainable sourcing. So sustainability is not a niche. It is really the way to do business. Organic is the way to do business. We have learned it the hard way this year where people are looking for immunity. Now let us speak about competencies to close this, if I may. So we wanted to do the same at our Horana factory and start exporting, and I'm sure many of the companies wanted to do the same. And I must say that Horana is under the BOI as well, and we benefit from their help and advice. And here you see the ingenuity of a team. We have just given the brief, and exactly as Prabhash said, we said, why don't you go for $1 billion of export? A team that I didn't create, they created themselves as a scrum team. My big hi to the Horana team from where I stand today. And just actually last month, we closed a small export bill, $250,000 is not a lot, but for me, is a signal that when you put something in your mind, you will get it. I have absolutely no doubt that this $250,000 will become $1 billion and will become $10 billion because the team has cracked it in the difficult time of COVID and it's a done deal. So now we will build on it. So this is how I believe that really a company is like ours, like those that are present today, don't have only a role. We have a responsibility towards export because the reality is the more I export, the more my Sri Lankan product sits internationally, the more FDI will come and this will generate hopefully a positive virtuous circle. Thank you.
Thanks, Hajam. I mean, that's very relevant. And I guess brands with a purpose would last a lifetime, right? Praveer, more domestic to you, being in the real estate and construction industry, with COVID, I'm sure you've got, as an industry, faced tough times. How would you all pivot your industry to leverage on some of the opportunities the adjacent industries are going to see?
Yes. The construction industry, which has property, infrastructure, all of those involved in, as well as the supply base, actually accounts to about 7% of GDP. And traditionally, if I look at 4 years or before 2014, this sector had been growing year on year from 8 to 10% and driving the growth rate of the economy as well. However, over the last 4 years, due to various reasons, we have found the construction industry has actually slowed down. And in two of those years, it even had negative growth. So this is a result of a number of factors, including a more high interest rate regime, high tax rate regime, as well as the slowing down of the economic activity in the country. So with that, as you know, in 2019, we had the Easter Sunday attack. And now, the worst of it has been the COVID-19. So it's not very easy under these circumstances to be able to revive this economy overnight and to contribute towards the private sector-led development agenda. However, while saying that, if I just break down the industry into two categories, the property industry, and the property and real estate on one side, as well as the infrastructure on the other side. If I take different type of asset classes, we all know the hotels industry, as well as the retail industry is going through extremely difficult circumstances. So I don't believe there'll be additional investment taking place in the short to medium term in these sectors, other than for ongoing projects. On the other hand, if you look at luxury living, condominium living, or as well as commercial buildings like office spaces. There again, the demand for that is a direct result of economic activity and social development. And at the moment, there is adequate stock. Some may claim there is an oversupply situation. So there again, I don't believe there'll be additional investments pouring into these areas in the short to medium term. However, there's a huge dearth of supply and a high unmet demand for affordable housing, more for the lower and mid-income families, for the affordable housing in Colombo as well as the greater Colombo areas that we see. So this is an area there is demand, and I believe from 2019 onwards, there has been a reversal where we have found the monetary policy and the fiscal policy interventions have created lower interest rate regime, and even the newer budget that was announced had stipulated mortgage finances to be supplied at 7% per annum. So those are enabling to grow that sector. Likewise, from 2019 onwards, we found VAT on condominium properties being abolished. We found even VAT and income tax rates on construction companies being drastically reduced. So that gives the opportunity for these companies to focus and try to survive and grow in this type of environment. And I think it was mentioned by all the other speakers and the panelists as well. In this budget this time, there was a reversal where certain trust industries were offered very attractive incentives in the form of tax holidays. We had not seen the concept of tax holidays had been abolished a few years ago, but it has been reintroduced. And I totally believe that that's the only way to mobilize additional investment, especially FDIs as well, which is necessary to allocate the resources to certain identified sectors of the economy. So some of those sectors that have been identified, whether it's in manufacturing, dairy, ITC, pharmaceuticals, et cetera, that will create additional growth for industrial properties as well as warehousing properties, which should be, again, a more positive towards the construction industry. If I take on the other side, the infrastructure development, here again, due to budgetary constraints over the last few years, we have had lower or limited investment from the government in infrastructure. But we saw there was a commitment in the new budget to reinvest in infrastructure, in roads, bridges, highways, etc. And there was incentives offered to reduce the import-related costs for the building materials for that industry. So that leaves some degree of optimism that there will be a revival in the construction industry, as well as wherever we find capital is a constraint for the government by accommodating the private sector in the form of PPPs in the infrastructure development, whether it's ports or mass rail transport or energy, those will be the catalyst points to grow the construction industry in the short term.
Thanks, Praveer. Harsha, if I can move on to you. I'm just, because you're sitting in Singapore and you have an outside in view here, tell us in your experience and with what you've seen in the region, are there any specific verticals we could choose to play in, and how should we play and why should we play in that place?
Yeah, thanks, Praveer. I have to say that I'm quite intrigued by the sharings that has come through, especially from Prabhash and Sanjay. The plans that we are talking about is quite encouraging. From a foreign investor's perspective, when they look at these, I think it'll go a long way in terms of what we can do to attract. So when we think about sector verticals, I think it's quite important to think about ecosystems, which is what some of the countries have done very effectively, right? I mean, you reverse 60 years back and think about where Singapore was. It was a country that had absolutely no local resources. It had just separated from Malaysia and had absolutely no national resources to build on, right? But they looked at their geographic positioning, and they actually picked a couple of verticals with the mindset of wanting to create a hub for the region. And that is what they have actually kept a very interesting focus on. And as a result, today, if you take the aviation sector and the airport and the airline, it accounts for about 15% of the economy. And the implications of COVID-19 has been quite severe, right? So we got to be very thoughtful about when you pick a particular sector or a infrastructure project, I think we need to have a mindset of how to link and think through ecosystems, because that's when you really see the impact for the long haul, right? And these are not going to be initiatives that you would actually be able to see the results overnight within a 12-month period. It takes a long period of time. And the point was made earlier about the relevance of maintaining some policy stability. It is absolutely critical. I think that's been one of the biggest problems that we have had. Even when we bet on different verticals, we have just not been able to keep our commitments to that vertical for the long haul. And if you can't keep that for at least a 10-year period, you don't actually build sustainable industries in a country. And that's something that we need to take on board. Kasturi, I'll just add one more point about the FDIs as well, because we have not talked about FDIs as much in this forum. I think when we think about FDIs, it is not just a government-to-government focus that we need to have. We need to target the next Unilevers that should think about us as a market, right? And some of the multinationals that are operating, I mean, they're very large businesses. They can actually make shifts just like another country can make. And the ecosystems that they can create as a result is quite powerful, right? This is a mindset that is there in most advanced economies. You take Hong Kong, you take countries like Singapore, even countries like Vietnam and Indonesia that we talked about. These governments don't just talk to create multilateral arrangements with governments. I mean, that is a baseline that you need to have, but you need to engage the private sector capital, which is quite important. Just in Asia-Pac markets, right, there are $280 billion to invest in private equity. And this is not taking into account any of the corporate settings, right? And Sri Lanka is not even on the radar of any of those funds. Why? Because we have never engaged. And we have never gone to any of the multinationals and tried to engage them as if though they are large economies. And I think there's a big opportunity when you think about sectors, when you think about verticals that you want to create. If you can't attract foreign direct investment, it is impossible for us to imagine that we will be able to get to the levels of activities that we're planning here.
Thanks, Arsha. I'll touch base with Sanjay, but before that, Prabash, you did say there were six vertical thrust export verticals you were talking about from an EDP's perspective. I'm curious to see just stepping from the FDI, Harsha alluded to. Are there specific markets which you think those thrust industries could compete in, and why and how should we compete? Are there any enablers you all have in place?
I don't think there's any answer that I can give it to in 2 minutes. But just to step back and tell you, what we've been looking at the EDB fundamentally this year is trying to do targeted sales. Sri Lanka historically has been trying to sell everything everywhere, whereas we've changed direction in 2020 by focusing on specific products dedicated to specific markets in different parts of the world. And we've been working with our foreign missions around that. So that's the strategy. So even though we can have trust industries, it doesn't necessarily mean it's every single market out there. If you don't go on a focused approach, we're not going to be successful. There's no way you can sell everything everywhere. And I think that's one of the mistakes we made historically, which we've been working on changing this year.
Thanks. I presume we'll be having market access programs in place for those.
Absolutely.
Okay. Sanjay, there is a couple of questions put in one, and I'll need a short answer. Sure. Stepping from the FDIs, one aspect is that, and the next is also a question about main trade barriers and ease of doing business. While you talk about that, we need to address the other side of it as well. what steps are you all taking in terms of eliminating trade barriers as well as improving our ease of doing business?
If you think about like ease of doing business, BOI has taken a lead role, try to improve our rankings. I think we are at 99 to get to about 63. And my vision is to get to at least about 50. So there's a saying that when I was young, aim to the stars, at least you'll end up on a coconut tree. But if you really think about what aspects that we need to change, I think there are multiple dimensions, but the things that we can quickly fix are around paying taxes, trading across borders, starting a business, resolving insolvency and contract enforcement. We are actually almost at the bottom. So it's easy to come up. And I think the reason why I think these can be moved quickly is that if you look at the framework that's put by the put through in the budget as well, right? So you're going to have a unique ID that's going to be introduced, along with that the tax ID is going to be linked to that. The COVID actually was a blessing in disguise, because our custom process was never online, and we've been trying to do that for multiple years. Now things are online, so there are many services being provided online, and I think it's just a matter of continuing that. So in that light, I think the ICTA has also been elevated to a institution that provides national guidance along with the cybersecurity to be able to create that underlying infrastructure, be able to provide those services. I think providing services efficiently and a cost-effective way is one of the thrusts, the primary thrust in improving the ease of doing business. And I think the cabinet subcommittee I mentioned to you earlier will definitely help in this endeavor. So we have already identified what aspects that we need to do in the next 2 to 3 months, next six months to 1 year, and by about 2023, what we need to pull in. So I think that will definitely drive ease of doing business. And the second question was about the trade tariffs and the barriers.
How
and
important
things like that.
Are those market access?
I think they're absolutely important. And I think we have this perception of once bitten, twice shy, and not to have broad trade agreements because they have not worked for us. I think it's a matter of like how we negotiate, not just looking at right immediately access to the markets for the products that we're trying to sell, but really think about 10 years in advance and say, what kind of economy are we trying to build? And then get access to those verticals. So even if it is not broad scale FTAs, a bilateral or multilateral, sector-specific trade arrangements, tariffs, barrier reductions are needed. I think otherwise we would not move, and it will be just still another pipe dream 3 years down the line, which I don't think none of us want to live in.
Okay, there is a question for you, Harsha. How can we reproduce the ecosystem around electronics that was developed in Penang? And what steps do we have to make to spark this?
Yeah, so I mean, We have histories of creating this very well, right? If you think about the free trade zones that we created, I think we were probably one of the first countries in Asia that ever to create free trade zones, right? And the industries that we invited actually created a lot of success for us, but we didn't maintain that, right? We didn't actually carry that through. So if you look at ecosystems like electronics that is created in Penang, I mean, these are very targeted local economic initiatives that are taken by different countries, right? But before we go down that path, I think we need to have some base aspects that we need to put in place, which is really quite critical to attract the different types of industries that we want to attract. We don't want every type of industry to come. We want to have industries that actually adds value to the country as well as creates better jobs for our people, right? So I don't think it is that difficult to create pockets of places where you could actually target and create certain types of industries to be attracted. This is what China is doing. This is what India is doing. This is what Indonesia is doing. Everyone is on the same kind of a pathway, but there's a very different baseline aspect to all of this. That's what we talked about policies, taxation, I mean, we need to simplify our taxation. We need to make it attractive. We have not been able to shed the mindset that we had during the war in creating different layers and layers of taxes, right? We've not been able to remove that. So those are the things that I think we need to be thinking through when you're looking at creating certain hubs.
Okay, thanks. Prabhash, would you like to weigh in on that quickly? Because as an EDB chairman?
I think it starts from creating the zones. And I think, I mean, already BUI is already looking at that and Sanjay can add into that. So creating dedicated zones and creating an environment and then creating an enabling environment by creating specific market access for such kinds of investments and also being able to take product to the market.
Okay, Praveen, there is a question here for you. There was a huge expansion in the property development market that we saw pre-pandemic. And how is it playing out now? And what is the government's, how can government intervene to kind of prevent a fallout here?
Yeah, most of the investments that went to new property developments were actually 5 years, 4 years, and 3 years ago. Thereafter, there hasn't been many significant investments in property, though ongoing projects eventually came into realization. At the moment as well, you will find, if I take the different areas in commercial properties, you will find about one new property came up, the Shangri-La office tower came up, as well as there's two more large properties, one developed by us at Havelock City and one by John Keels as well, which will come into market next year. But all those investment decisions were made when the environment was much conducive and there was substantial growth in economic activities. Because in the property sector in particular, you know, property sector is a direct beneficiary of stable political, economic, and social developments that take place in a country. Again, with the rush into the property development in luxury housing, now we have found there is quite a large stock of unsold apartments. There's almost 8,000 units available in the market, where the offtakes, though we are not sure, it may be as much low as 500 to 600 per annum. So under those circumstances, I don't think it'll be easy for anyone to go into those areas. But as I mentioned earlier, in areas of affordable housing, now, that's an area that we can look at. And again, it's challenging because our cost structures are quite relatively high in Sri Lanka to be able to build housing at affordable costs. So to make it available to the low-income segments. So that's a challenge that we have to face. And that's where if government also intervenes in PPP arrangements, where they give the land and make sure the developers develop the property and jointly hand it over to the low-income families. I think that's one area that we can see a future development in.
Thanks. A quick one for Prabhash. Prabhash, you did mention that you were advocating that we all move into an agile kind of a workforce. How important is that our labor laws be adapted and changed to accommodate the change in requirement in competencies and the workforce agility?
Simple answer is yes, it is extremely important. But it's not a big, it's not a simple problem that you can solve overnight. So we'll have to do that gradually. And we've seen that. I mean, even if we talk about early part of this year, there was so much flexibility with C-19 hitting the manufacturing sector, where there was flexibility given in terms of workarounds on the labor laws. So, I mean, it's a problem that's been around for a long time. I don't think you can have a one immediate solution, but a solution over a period of time.
Okay, thanks. Sanjay, on FDI is okay, to facilitate FDI is important, but Sri Lanka being the size we are, and there are certain elements we are not competitive in the cost. What are the elements you think we need to be competitive in? Other than just having your policy and stability in place?
I think one of the major areas that we need to be competitive is in our energy cost. Right? So I think we are somewhat competitive, but we are not the cheapest. And the reason is because today our production cost is average about 15, 16 rupees, and our industry power cost is about 11 plus the phase tariffs. So that has to come in. And I think the initiative that HE has put down in terms of getting renewables, because now you're getting renewables, even proposal in Sri Lanka around 3 to 5 cents at utility scale. So that means about 5-6 rupees of power. So that actually will get you a competitive advantage. Secondly, I think the most important thing is the keeping our workforce current and also current relevant and also skilled. We have one of the most educated and versatile workforce, but we need to continue to do that. But I think given that out of under BOI, close to about 600,000 direct employment, 300,000 is in garments, apparel sector. But that sector is valuable, but it's a sector that where somebody joins and pretty much stays in the sector. So we need to be able to reskill them, upskill them, and move into different sectors that the verticals that we talked about. So if we do those two or three things, I think we will definitely be continue to be competitive on the verticals that we are looking at.
Okay, thanks. So in a final round for all of you, just a quick answer on where do you think any other key element we need to focus on? And I'll start with Haja here. In order for us to actually kickstart this economy, while we spoke about FDI and all the support in getting export going, are there any key elements we're missing? Or we need to focus on to kickstart the economy.
Thank you, Kasturi. I think some elements we have not spoken yet about. One is partnership, the importance of putting our minds together as a private sector. Let's be honest that this year, whilst we have all been connected, we have not been cooperating together. And we have seen that even at a country level, closing, not giving masks, not giving PPEs. Only now that the search of a vaccine is there, scientists are putting their minds together. The reality is all of us need all of us. Creating a circular economy so that sustainability is not a niche anymore, as Prabash had said. This needs like-minded people that are geared towards that. So for me, partnership is extremely important, and it starts today with this economic summit in reality. The second point is leadership. The playbook of leadership has been distorted. It's not about power, it's not about authority. It's about trusting your people wherever they are, working from home or wherever they are. It's about followership, it's about invitation to think differently and to create novel ideas. And lastly, I think Sanjaya had said it, is about the human capital, because the reality is we have to reward high performers, pay them well, nurture them, grow them, let them find their purpose and their passion. But we also have to deal with recurrent low performers, as Prabash has alluded to. We need to create a more diverse, gender balanced, where the youth are operating just as much as the seniors, because they are those who will become those that are sitting in this table today. And for me, lastly, it goes with the moral authority that we have a code of business principle that we don't live on the wall, that we live every day, that this cooperation between the private sector becomes the only way for us to do business. Sri Lanka is a small country, but can get there. The Netherlands is the second exporter in the world of agriculture or horticulture. The Netherlands, 16 million population. We definitely can do.
Thanks. Sanjay, a quick one of what do you think we should focus on?
Actually, Haja covered most of the points. I would say one is that, like, if you look at Prabash and myself, we've both come from private sector and taken on public sector roles. I think the vision and the objectives, meaning in terms of what we need to try to get to, is coming through. But the execution is what we need to make sure, ensure. So public-private partnership is a must to make this reality, the dream a reality. Otherwise, it will remain a dream and we might end up talking about it again next year.
Thank you. And Praveer?
I think we have to work towards creating all the necessary enablers for competitiveness to grow. Basically, whether it's archaic labor laws or whether it's lack of technology investment, or, for example, even giving a very protectionist approach being taken to protect certain local industries. Because if we cannot change those and open out, we'll never be competitive to look at larger markets overseas.
Prabhash, from EDB perspective, is there anything else, any other element we have missed?
I think I've spoken quite a bit from the EDB perspective, but I think more importantly, it's about changing mindset and managing expectations. Historically in Sri Lanka, we have had this fixed mindset which needs to change for us to grow. And I think we've spoken about some of the ways we can do that. At the same time, managing expectations. In Sri Lanka, if somebody wants to invest in a business, they expect a return tomorrow. If you invest in industry, you're not going to get a return tomorrow. It can take 3 years, 5 years, 7 years to get a return. So I think it's all about managing expectations and changing mindset and how to do that sustainably. So if we have, as we've got all these plans, we need to stay focused on that and be able to get through that and get the execution part done. So it's really important that we're able to manage expectations as well as changing mindset for us to be a global hub and to be where we want, where Sri Lanka should truly be at.
That's so true. Harsha, any last words for all of us here?
Yeah, so I agree with everything that's been said. I would just say one thing about that we have probably missed a very critical aspect. That's about investing into education and our people, right? I mean, I entirely studied in Sri Lanka. I qualified in Sri Lanka before I left. And I'm eternally grateful for the opportunity that I got through the free education system. But somehow along the way, we have kind of neglected that, right? The teaching profession, I don't think we have invested that much to the teaching profession. But if you were to think about a long-term success for the country, and if you want to create a change in mindset, you got to have good educators and a good education system. So that would be the only thing that I would add.
Thanks, Harsha. Thanks, Prabhash and Harsha, the two speakers and the panelists here, Harsha, Sanjay, and Praveer. And with this, this session would be coming to an end. Thank you, everyone, for joining in.